So we are ready to start with the last lecture. The lecturer is going to deliver his lecture, his talk from Crete. He has to travel, the last moment he has to travel to Brussels for a meeting. So he's going to, before he moves to the airport, he's going to give this talk. And then immediately afterwards, he's going to depart to Brussels. So his professor, Manolis Stratakis, you know, three of his students and one close collaborator of his, Ioannis Konizakis, is here. He's going to talk about ultra-fast laser engineering in materials and diagnostics. They are world famous about this work that they are doing in the research institution. And Manolis, if you hear me, you have like 45 minutes from now, okay?
Exactly. Okay. Thank you, Kostas.
Yeah, you can start.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
Good. Thank you very much for the introduction, Kostas, and I apologize that I'm not there today. It was the last minute as Kostas explained obligation, so I will try to provide you an overview of how we can use ultra-fast lasers for materials engineering and diagnostics. I'm Manolis Stratakis, I'm a research director at the Foundation of Research and Technology Hellas. This is fourth, actually it's in the island of Crete, that it is in the southern part of Greece. It's an island, but you can snow at the back, so it's actually a big island, but you can enjoy, of course, you can enjoy the sea. So today, let me tell something about FORT, what is actually FORT and how this is, FORT is among the research institutes in Europe. So FORT ranks 20th by the European Commission as far as the attraction of funding. It's the worldwide leader in optics and photonics, according to a RAND study, and also is actually a founding member of European Research Infrastructure. So I will explain on that later. So today, a quick overview of how to understand that we are a laser properties. And the activities, the pool of the activities we are currently working start from the end of the fast laser process. I thought how fast lasers interact with materials, and based on these notepads to attain to 8 an ensemble of fractures, material surfaces, starting for example, from hierarchical structures that complement the micro scales, practically nanostructures created by ultra-fast techniques. So you can see in a set can create, and then to use this kind of structures for different kind of applications, for example, for extreme wetting and microfluidics, biological. So this structures, and lately the past 10 years or so, we have a quite, let's say, increased activity in photovoltaics, in organic photovoltaics mainly, but also in perovskite photovoltaics, also on how lasers use materials and how can use ultra-fast lasers to diagnose them. Now, this outlook of my talk, in the first half of my talk, I would like to present how use ultra-fast for biometric structure, solid surfaces, and we will talk the extreme wetting under infection insulin applications. And in the second part of my talk, I'd like to explain to you how we can use fast lasers for novel materials, synthesis, and diagnostic energy related applications. Let's go to the first part of the talk. As I said, using ultra-fast laser, I mimic the surfaces that are found in nature. You can see here different examples, starting, for example, from the colocasias, petrophobicity, water repellence, self-cleaning. Nature always inspires us because it can provide, let's say, solutions for its problems. So it's a very good. We can also observe directional properties in specific lizards and bugs. Also, low underwater friction properties, For example, the shark skin, and also remarkable under-reflective properties of some butterfly and other. And we'd like to do this by fast laser materials processing. It's an emerging, exciting field. I will show you that this is all. It enables ultimate control of light by matter and matter by light. It allows both surface in-body photochemical processes based on nonlinear effects, and it also encourages fundamental studies of laser materials interaction influence materials processing at the primary time scales. I hope I will convince you that it is an ideal tool for micro and nanoscale applications. Now, this is actually how the different phenomena involve upon laser material interaction with the ultrasound passes. When we say ultrasound, we pass that of duration more than picosecond. So, in upon excitation, we have electron tracing and electron cooling. So, we have excitation of the electronic system at the primary time scales. Then there is the critical time scale in the order of picosecond, when we have the interaction of electron with the lattice. So, we have coupling of electron with the lattice, and this happens at the picosecond time scale. So, this actually time scale separates the non-thermal effects. Non-thermal means that we have electronic excitation of the electronic system to thermal effects, that the electrons have exchanged their energy with the lattice. So it's very critical when a pulse interacts with the material. You can see here a femtosecond pulse compared to nanosecond. So a femtosecond pulse, we have an excitation only the electronic system, whereas during the pulse, whereas when we have a large pulse, a nanosecond pulse, magenta here, then we have all this thermal and thermal effect. So what is the thermal effect? Actually, we have this non-equilibrium thermal melting of the lattice, we have heat diffusion, and at the end, we have what we say material loss either vaporization, normal boiling, or explosive boiling, called material ablation. So this is very important to separate the non-thermal from thermal effects, femtosecond pulses. And this is the result that we follow like the process with ultra-short pulses. See here the difference between the long and short pulses. In the long pulses, we have a significant collateral damage, we have significant thermal diffusion and heat diffusion, so we have a very different outcome, processing outcome than in the femtosecond. You can see here that the collateral damage is significantly high. So, about materials, it's actually very conventional. It's got laser micro machining. So, this is laser induced ablation of materials. And in a sense, essentially, we take the beam and then we put it on the surface and create different patterns. And this is what we call laser ablation. However, with the advent of femtosecond, we have the creation of so called self-assemblies. So these are structures that are in, at the beams. You can see here in of this people like structures that are inside the beam. In this case, we have material ablation and we have a self-assembly. These are pseudo-periodic structures from the material melt. And this actually provides us the capability of creation of structure beyond the traction. And here I can explain the difference between micro machining laser ablation compared to surface structures. You can see here this track created the Gaussian distribution of the laser pulse, and then you can see that how these are created with the beam spot that is much different than the micro machining applications. So with this actual ultrasound, you can create example structures. Here you can see a specific example. This is silicon. The pulse duration is 200 seconds at the wavelength of 1026 nanometers, and the frequency is constant. Whereas we increase the number of incident pulses on the surface, and you can see that at very low number of pulses, we have creation of deep ripples, morphology, and this actually the orientation of these ripples is perpendicular to the incident polarization field, laser polarization, We have at a bit number of passes, we have the creation of micro. So these micro groups actually, you can see here that wavelength is much higher than periodicity of the laser, and you can see that it's oriented partly to the polarization, whereas at the higher number passes have the creation of micro spikes. In all these cases, you can observe that the periodicity is higher or equal to the wavelength through the wave. So we have started some years ago trying to interpret the origin of this structural formation, and we ended up in the complemented hydrodynamics complemented with electrodynamics model. I will not go. I can say that the module is the dynamic surface case. So we have a surface wave that interferes with the incident beam. This is the hydrodynamic part. And then we have the hydrodynamics of the melt, since the material is melting, and then the gradient perforation drives very important hydrodynamic effects. So it's a coupled model, and via this model, can account for the location of these structures, reduced surface assembly structures on the surfaces, and you can actually take this location of these structures in different kinds of materials, like silicon, metallic materials, this is a kind of steel, and also for dielectrics. This effect of surface assembly structures actually a universal effect. Of course, it is created on different irradiation parameters that can be observed in many kinds of solids. Now, as I mentioned, we would like to create large areas of this kind of structures in order to mimic the unique structures that can be found in nature. And this is done actually by taking the number of incident parts of the sample. So, we have this test. The beam is emitted from a femtosecond laser, and then it is driven using different optics onto the samples, translated on the samples. So normally, change the number of passes for the frequency, and actually this changes the energy. So this is an example. We have started actually in 2008. Here, how silicon we can start from a polystyrene surface, and then by upon change the influence, you can change the roughness of the surface, starting from a sub-micron roughness. Here, this is the scale by 100 nanometers at very low fluences, actually to very high fluences, 2.25. You can see this creation of this pseudo-bed microstructures. So, when changing the net density, we also can change the wetting properties of the surface, starting from a less hydrophilic to a super hydrophilic at the very high fluences. And the beauty of this technique that you can control also the microscope, that you can also induce a spontaneous roughness at the nanoscale, and you have improved on that, and you have lately, using this technique, you have has to create also a narrow distribution of kind of sub-micron tracked microscope. So it is essentially a hierarchical structure that comprises both the microscale and nanoscale structures. And we have started at 2008 in actual super properties of the log clip. See here that this silicon structure surface is not only remarkable in terms of the morphological characteristics, but also on the wet properties. So these structures are not super hydrophobic as the lotus, and you can see here how a sphere is actually behaves when this is a droplet that it falls on the natural surface. You can see here that it repels like a perfect elastic sphere because hydrophobic surface, and the same can be seen in our structured surface, the structured area, the center of the sample, and the droplet is falling on the surface, and then you can see also that you have this different water repellence structured surface. So So there are both similar pillars as well as also on the wedding. Now we have, since then we have started different kinds of functional fluids that nature can show us. Here I can show you another example that is a directional fluid transfer product. So specific lizard actually, and this bug, what they actually is that they harvest, because they live in dry environment, they harvest hot water from humidity during the night time, and then they harvest this their entanglement, and then they put a peculiar network of channels transport water droplet from their entanglement to their mouth to other themselves. So this is actually an example of directional fluid transfer properties, and this is actually accomplished by this kind of mechanisms that are present in both in the entanglement of both animals. So in an effort to mimic this directional fluid transfer, we have, thought that if we create a grad surface test, so we have a stripe of the material, and then we structure this stripe to induce hydrophobic properties, and then we progress, change the hydrophobic property to more hydrophilic when we push from one side to the other. So we decrease the roughness, and in this case, we increase the hydrophilicity. Then, if one leaves a water droplet on this side, then we spontaneously move to the other side. This induces actually directional fluid transfer. And we have realized this kind of structure. This is actually the flat surface. And then we progress to increase the height of the structures. So the structures become less hydrophilic as we go from one side to the other. And this is what it happens. So this is actually an example of the structure with a surface tension. And this is a water droplet that is back on the hydrophobic part. And then spontaneously to the whole surface. And this is actually running uphill. It's running uphill with a velocity of 50 centimeter per second. So this directional fluid transfer properties is very appealing. And then actually we end up to think how we can increase more the complexity of this kind of structures. Since until now we have talked about the specific structures. So in this effort actually to mimic more complex surfaces, for example, you can see here the shark skin surface comprises this plaque that have a second, a primary, let's say, structure, but you can also see inside this course you have secondary structure, and it's highly complex structure. So we create more complex structures using ultrafast lasers. And what we came in our mind was change the polarization. You remember that lips actually are perpendicular laser polarization, and the are oriented pattern to the laser. So when one changes the polarization, you can see here in the linear case, you can see these stripes that are oriented perpendicular to the laser polarization, but if one uses a radial or azimuthal polarization, then one can induce a radial or azimuthal of these lips structures. And the effect becomes much more implicable if one translates the laser beam into the surface. When, of course, you have a linear beam, then you can only create one frequency. So this is the single frequency that one is creating when translating a linear laser beam, whereas a radial or azimuthal polarization, then one can create more frequencies, can induce more frequencies, and there the surface becomes complex. You can see here the effect of this structure. To cut the long story, actually this structure resembles very well the shark skin structure, and we have realized this actually during a pet-op project that it's called Pina Biocrit. This is end now, but this project after the have the problem how we can use ultrasound pulse laser processing in order to reduce the friction when two surfaces are in contact with each other. And together with it, we have actually pushed this fracture on a scientific of a combustion engine. And you can see here this is an electrical shaft, and we have treated half of this shaft with the shark skin like structure, and half of the gun is untreated. And then connect this shaft on bearing cell segment, and then we have tested this and measured the friction properties. You can see here the machine that repeats that it, this shaft is tested. And what we remarkably observe actually is that this laser structure travels at least at the lower velocity of at lower velocity of test, the dynamic action coefficient can be very much lower, and the reduction can be up 50%. And this is a remarkable number actually, because it can provide, you understand that the applications of this kind of mechanical components is large. I mean, so this is actually a patent submitted together with Spanish colleagues, and this result also attracted media interest. And you can visit this link, and you can see how you can present this technology to users. Now let's go to a different, let's say, structure, but it is in the same manner. So far, I have tested that all the structures that are used these techniques are, the precision of these structures is higher or equal to the laser wavelength. So in this case, actually, you can see how one specific radiation conditions can induce structures that are, let's say, much lower than the laser web. Here is an example, a fused silica glass, and you can see that structures actually exhibit a periodicity that it is equal to 200 nanometers on the left and on the right hand side. Structures are essentially, they have this that it is much lower than the laser web. And this is a structure, so you can see the characteristics. This nanopillar that can be induced on the glass surface. You can see here a cross section of this structure and the height. So you can see it's another 200 nanometers, and the radius is about, the radius of cube, this is about 180 nanometers. And one measures about actually what is the effect of these structures on the reflectivity of the surface. Can observe this result on the reflectivity as a function of the wavelength, the planar, the six side, and the double side. You can see we have at least three times lower reflex in the double sided than the untreated area. So, this is another pattern we have submitted, and this is the optical effect. In this application, we try to mimic the remarkable underreflectivity of this wing to specific butterflies. GADA species, and here is a glass slide. It is laser treated using this sub-wavelet technique, structural technique, and the center area, and you can see the remarkable difference on the reflectivity of the central area compared to the untreated area that it is on the side, on the periphery. So this is an important effect actually, and here you can see also these structures are much similar structures that are on the surface of cicada, specific cicada species. And this remarkable and the effect not only observed at the normal incidence, but you can see here that it is quite effective in other directions. You can see here in the RTFT colors how this double-sided track can show remarkably lower reflection than the planar. So, and of course, we have explained this is just to advanced materials, this work, but it's also provided us an opportunity to pair this technology with the conventional approach to reflection. The most important approach is actually the multi-layer deposition at the top of the glass. This is a single step that is done on by laser rastering of the glass surface. The convection is actually quite not perfectly, and also there is a big problem. So you can see, for example, that on the prolonged there are some these materials are the light in the surface. This is all good. I mean, this damage is actually under control. On the other hand, this is how both actually perfect anti-reflection, but also it is a permanent, because this process is performed onto the glass surface itself. Now we have, of course, we have several types of glass, and also sapphire. They are, because the applications this anti-reflection coat starts and span from small areas like, let's say, lead optics watches to large areas, including dice. And in this, actually, we tried to set up a spin-off company of work that is called Biomimetic, and we try to use this for different kinds of materials, semiconductors, metals, dry and dielectrics. And now you are exactly to have this company to start this one. Let me briefly now go to the what we call the biological application of this structure, and actually focus on neuron cells and explain what is actually our main aim. The aim is actually manipulate the cell or the neural cell environment, so to create platform structure in order to control the adhesion or depletion and differentiation of on these contactive surfaces. The second step is these surfaces, and this is facing a series of electrodes on contactive surfaces, and the main, but they actually create a construct using layers that can be replaced between the damaged tissue. This is a neuron is done. We place this construct between the two parts damaged, and we aim actually generate the damage. So this is actually the main aim, and it can be done by combining the methods from the one and two, let's say previous aims. So in the effort of the neurons, the neuronal network activity can be influenced by several. Of course, there are many studies, there are continuous and discontinuous topographies. We are the first that we have studied discontinuous and anisotropic topography. And actually, this is a discontinuous ellipsoidal-like topography with differential orientation. It's a discontinuous and anisotropic topography at the same time. So these are the surfaces. This actually in the low second surface, you can see that there is no preferential orientation axis. However, this is not a medium high roughness when you see it in the numbers as well. There is a preferential orientation. This axis opens this direction, and also this the cross section of this axis is the ellipsoid. So this is actually a discontinuous tropic topographic structure. And this is the result. It's in the biomaterial sample. You can see this is the low roughness. The network, the neural network of SEG neurons that is developed on this surface, low roughness case, then it's in the high roughness. You can see here a preferential orientation of these neurons in the medium and more on the high roughness. This is, however, this is not the case for roughness. So in this case, we have a net induced by the surface topography underneath. You can see it also in numbers here. So deep place destruction technique can have a tool to control how the neural network is developed onto a surface. And this is not happening only for itself. This is actually a culture of a whole dorsal root ganglion explant. This is from the 13.5 day mouse embryo. So this ganglion is extracted from the brain of the mouse, then it is cultured on a low roughness that it's as an isotropic and high roughness structure that highly unstable. And you can see here that the production of the neurons of this ganglion is isotropic in the case of the low roughness, but highly anisotropic and with the specific orientation on the high roughness. We have elaborated structurally capable. So I show an example on how we can orient neurons on top of surface, but this is an example that we found actually a structure neurons cannot adhere, and this is the nanorhythm structure. So here you can see lines that actually you can see that there are micropoles in this, however outside the lines are. And what one can observe that is neurons can grow only inside the lines where the structure is present, but this the case outside, you can see that the state of the structures. Essentially, you have a pattern using this technique. You can, for example, write the fourth initials using, in this case, you can see it in this picture. So, using this technique, you have a very good to control the orientation, but also to control the pattern top of a surface. So the next step, as I explained, is actually to place electrodes on the top of this microconical structure, and then I interface to map the neuronal activity structures of the neurons that are developed on the top of these structures. We are doing this with collaboration with Pierre Hosson of Cartesian Fund. What we have done so far, actually, we have created this structure for. And a med probe, this is actually commercially available multi-molecular array. So we have used this technique to use this kind of structure on this array. So here is the multi-electrode. Then have the inputs that are exposed. But between electrodes, we can have some of this microstructure. So we are in the progress of testing. The process of testing these structures, and then we hope we will have soon the first result can, of course, interface the activity compared to the plant. Let me now, part of the talk is related to how can you use ultrafast lasers to develop novel materials and diagnostic energy-related applications. And back 10 years ago, actually, I collaborated with Eman Timakis from the Iranian University of Crete. And actually, he's expert in photovoltaics. And we have put into the field of light harvesting using plasmonic nanoparticles, metallic plasmonic particles. So this is essentially the processes that appeared upon the introduction of nanoparticles specific, let's say, position within the solar cell architecture. So this is the solar cell, you can see transparent electrode, the whole transport unit, and the active layer. So when the size of particles is too high, you have this scattering effect. In this case, we increase, let's say, the beam path, I mean, because of the attacks that can act as scatterers. Then at very low sizes, nanoparticle sizes, then have the excitation of the surface plasma field, and in this way you have transport of the electromagnetic field in the vicinity of nanoparticle. And in this case, it enhances more essentially the energy density that it is deposited of the active. And this is the third reason, the kinetic process of additional mode. This actually requires the particles to be distributed at a periodic, let's say, band inside the solar cell architecture. So we have actually elaborated more first two cases. So our contribution in the field is that we have the first actually that we have used lasers synthesized nanoparticles in plasmonic organic solar cell. So this is actually a physical synthetic approach. It's actually the of a solid target with light beam, and then of the metal layer with light beam, then a femtosecond beam is focused through the liquid layer on the target, and then upon ablation at the creation of nanoparticles inside the solvent. So the key advantage of this is that these particles use some atoms of some colloids of different quality using its technique. These particles are actually free of surface ablation layers because it's a physical technique and particles are termed with I inside the solvent. And ablating using pulses to minimize the formation of surface time. So this is the point in a remarkable, I mean, advantage compared to the chemical synthetic approaches, that the duration of interaction is wet, and then we have the formation of surface oxide, especially for noble metals. And that's for the first to show that the effect of the particles that are mediated with ligands is much higher than the effect of nanoparticles that are mediated with ligands. So this is actually our usually we have shown that ligands actually minimize or inhibit actually the plasmonic, the surface plasmon enhancement in the vicinity of the nanoparticles inside the actual layer. And then I've understood that what is the mechanism of these ligands and how to enhance the photovoltaic effect. I've tested, let's say, nanoparticle. You can see here an example. We have used nanorods, back reflect, and photovoltaics. But lately, we have used this in perovskites. Actually, in this case, is related to the placement actually, an alloy, a nanoparticle fraction, silver aluminum alloy. And you can see that we have not only observed an enhancement of effect to scatter, of course. These particles are the whole transporting layer, and not in the bed layer, we have enhancement due to scattering. These particles are, let's say, much higher, as I explained, but also a phenomenon of increasing the stability of solar cells. And this is due to the presence of aluminum that acts as a moisture barrier, the moisture to destroy the perovskite. We have also worked photon diagnostic. I visited actually the SRFB9, the European synchrotron, and actually this is actually the perfect experiment we have performed. And this is related to a sectional study, a type of X-ray beam, and this is a first time actually X-ray diffraction plus fluorescence impact of plasmonic organic photovoltaic devices. This is done in collaboration with Barbara Patsy and sent up to this very important publications. Of course, now we are moved to diagnostics, ultra-fast transmission spectroscopy. So this kind of structure, a couple of works that Ioannis Konidakis that is there will, I'm sure that he will explain in more detail in his presentation, and I'll keep it for now. Now, let me go on that, let's say, part of a study that is in collaboration also with Malachi Makis and also with his computer on how to ultra fast laser techniques in order. Solution process in organic photovoltaics, and this is actually how we work to replace the unconducted electrode using different graphene-based layers. How we can work on the whole crust layer, and how so we can work laser function solution process graphene in replacement to the PCBM, the fullerene receptor organic solars. So let me briefly explain how to realize this transparent graphene-based electrode. So this is actually what is back to 2010. This is done to analyze graphene-based electrodes, flexible graphene electrodes. In the first step, graphene film is reduced, actually is transferred from a processed, let's say, form to an oxidized form that is highly conductive. This is done on a hard substrate, a silicon-silicon dioxide. So first the layer is deposited of silicon dioxide. It is reduced by thermal or chemical means, and then it is transferred to the flexible substrate. However, this approach is not, let's say, compatible with the thermal, I mean, a single step with the thermal or the chemical reaction approaches, because the substrate very sensitive, both thermal and chemical. So we have done this that's on a flexible substrate using a step. So this is a laser, a femtosecond laser beam that it is rastered on the top of a layer, a graphene layer, that it is deposited onto the flexible substrate, and then after mastering of this beam, the graphene oxide layer is used, so the oxygen groups have been removed under the action of the layer, and the lattice is transferred from the oxidized form to the reduced. And this is done in a single step. And these are the characteristics of the reduction process, that the seed resistance is very much lowered by increasing the laser power, number of passes. And of course, one like actually to create a very highly conductive and sharp electrode, and he can also use the conductivity, but at the same time to the impedance. So here you can see that upon changing the layer thickness, then you can see that there's a significant reduction of the seed resistance. At the same time, we have reduction of the transmittance. So under, you can find this is the optimum thickness that of reduction. And then, upon identification of the optimum thickness, what we have done in series is use together with TOSAS, because see TOSAS here, that we have used this mesh-like structure. So first reduce, then we can induce best in order to increase the transparency more. And this is the structure, schematic of the structure we end up. And that is provided us direct, actually, an organic solution performance, see a flexible graphene-based conductive element. Let's go now to another, how we can apply this graphene-based on the whole transporting layer. Here you can see an example of interaction of a UV laser pulse lattice in the presence of a dot gas phase. So you actually radiate in the presence of the dot. And we hope that under this atom will end up to the incorporation of the dopant atoms in the graphene lattice. And this is actually the experiment, because here the spectra, irradiation of oxide in the presence of chlorine or ammonia. You can see that irradiation of chlorine by an additional peak, the chlorine 2P peak, and we also see that irradiation of ammonia, you can have the nitrogen peak disappearing. I will not explain the essential amino chains, because Costas sent me a message that the ammonia was finishing. But what I can see here is that you can, using this technique, you can tune the work function. So this actually material can be very well used as a whole transporting material, and to be compatible with most of the electrons actually that can be, have been used so far in the organic photovoltaic. And you can see, you can remark in the power of the solar cell upon application of chlorinated graphene type for supporting layer. We have this also to do type of materials the same. Actually, you can see here that a progressive actually move of the excitonic is actually, we have a decrease of the electricity. Material, so we have essentially p-type in these materials. This 1,005 millimeters. Let's keep this as actually, sorry. You can see, of course, you can, there is this review article that together with Kostas and summarizes all these capabilities in the photovoltaic but also storage systems. And let me think, actually, how that's even that it relates to polarization. It's a multi-photo spectroscopy of two-dimensional materials. And this is actually a system we have developed. It's a fully motorized transition safety sensor, second thermal generation, and two-fold electron emissions, electrofluorescence microscope. Actually, this is a non-linear microscope, a second imaging of a second thermal generation with the additional capability that we can excite the material using different polarized systems. So there is a polarizer, the sample, you can rotate the excitation, and can also use second harmonic analyzer. So this is called polarized second harmonic. And this is what is happening actually. This is a sick tungsten dioxide that are deposited on the substrate. And this is the second harmonic that in these crystals, and this is actually how the excitation the field is rotating. You see that upon the orientations of the excitation field, then one can observe struck crystals actually become on and off depending on polarization. And to cut the long story short, we can, this is actually optical thing of second harmonic generation, and on and off can be actually create the armchair and these crystals. So this particle of color image of the side is actually showing us this armchair orientation of crystal. So this is very remarkable because we use this capability in order to image the crystalline quality. So you can see here an example between different regions of interest. You can see that there are regions that white fusion of armchair angles. These are low quality regions. Whereas you can see also regions that with a very small distribution, very narrow distribution, they are angles. In this case, you can have a good distribution. So you have an optical lens that you can actually quantify this aligned quality, this CVD growth. Let me finish by, let's say, funding. We are have funding from mostly from European Commission for the 2020 project. Also, RENET and RAD, you all know that, and some national. I would like to stress so our capability to host different users from different countries. We have FA infrastructure, so you can apply this network, and then you can come perform experiments on data, spectroscopy, and diagnostics. And fabrication at no cost. So if your proposal is approved, then you can come here together with your colleague at no cost. And this is my group, it is actually a lot of people working here, and this is due to the fact that we have, let's say, a series of activities starting from biology and material science, optics. So this is why the group is a lot of. And this is the detail. So thank you very much for your attention. You can contact me, you can ask me any question, and by contacting me this address, electronic mail address. Thank you very much.
Thank you.